Hi again, it's Jason from Fraser Valley Rose Farm. I spend a lot of time trying to talk about good gardening practices, and one of those topics that come to me a fair amount is the uses of common household vinegar in the garden, supposedly for all sorts of uses. Now, horticulturally speaking, some of these uses are a little bit dubious. Some of them can even do more harm than good. So instead of spouting off again about the 10 miracles of vinegar, what I'll go through is 10 uses, supposedly, in the garden for vinegar in this video, and I will also rate them, give them a letter grade for their accuracy and usefulness. And because I don't want to be tearing something down without offering an alternative, where appropriate, I will offer additional alternatives of things that will be more useful than vinegar for those same situations. Use number one I'm going to talk about is using vinegar to adjust down the pH of your soil. And I'm going to give this one a letter grade of D, because although it's based somewhat in reality, or at least in the intuition, that if you add an acidic thing to your soil, it will make the soil more acidic, it is really a fundamental misunderstanding about how soil pH is made up. Soil is made up of a lot of minerals, and some of those minerals can be things like calcium, which tend to bring up the pH, or you can also have the availability through bacterial breakdown of things like sulfates and phosphates that tend to bring the pH down. I'm simplifying it massively here, but the truth is that the addition of vinegar may momentarily shock down the pH of your soil, may actually have an unwanted effect on the soil life as well, because bacteria like things a little bit stable. If you bring down their living environment in pH quickly, it may actually kill off some of your beneficial bacteria. And then, of course, once that solution of vinegar has washed through rainfall or whatever, then you end up with the soil minerals still being exactly the same as when you started. So it doesn't successfully adjust your soil pH over a length of time. As for alternatives, some people will recommend sulfur or aluminum sulfate. Both of those things will adjust down your pH over time. So will compost, although it's a slower process. Straight onto use number two, and this is the most common I hear recommended, is to use vinegar as a weed killer in the garden. That would call for you to place the vinegar straight up into a container like this and spray it onto weeds around the garden. Now, this has a tiny bit of merit insofar as vinegar is corrosive, and as a corrosive, it can damage tissues of plants, especially straight up 5% or in higher concentrations, as you can find it sometimes on the market, it can definitely damage those leaf tissues. The problem is that it's very ineffective against tap-rooted plants, first of all. So if you have something that's a creeper, a runner, or tap-rooted, you're going to burn those leaves temporarily. It will not kill the plant for sure, and that doesn't matter what weather or temperature you apply it in. The other thing to say is that even if you're trying to kill those shallow-rooted annual weeds that are young or germinating, you really have to pick a warm day. A day like this, where it's cloudy, a bit cool outside, or rain is expected, it just won't work. So I'm going to give this one a letter grade of, say, a C or maybe a C-, because it's something that can work, but it's not as effective as other things used for the same purpose. Certainly there are the chemical means which are far more effective than vinegar, but even given if you have a problem with using glyphosate or 2,4-D for controlling weeds, which I don't begrudge you, then the other thing that you can use, and most organic growers are moving over to this method, is to use flame weeders, which don't chemically affect the soil, and they burn the plants and can kill the tap roots as well. So that would be my alternative if you want to stay within the organic realm. Use number three I'm going to talk about is using it as an insecticide. So often they will talk about putting a vinegar solution, dilute vinegar solution, adding a drop of dish soap, as they always do in these recipes, and then spraying that onto insects on your plants. Here's the problem with this, and I'm going to tell you right up front, I'm giving it an F because there's just no good scientific basis for what's the right threshold for applying vinegar to your plants that will kill the insects but not kill the plant itself. One study that I found working on leaf hoppers found that you had to go up to an acetic acid content of up to 30% to kill off the leaf hoppers, Well, at 30%, that's 6 times more acidic than the household vinegar, which means that it's going to have a hell of a big effect on the foliage of your plants. So because they haven't found the right level to apply this at, that it could be damaging to the insects but not damaging to the plants, I definitely would not risk using this in my garden. Use number four, similarly, it's talked about using vinegar in a fungicide. Now, this one is, I'm gonna give it a D, because there's a little more basis in science for this one. That is, when they're trying to do post-harvest treatment of veggies and they're trying to hold off fungus, they will use a mist or an atomization of vinegar to try to treat it so they don't rot so quickly. That being said, once again, they have not found the right, or done the studies to find the right levels of vinegars that you would apply to try to harm fungus on plant foliage without harming the plant itself. In this case, there's a little more evidence to back baking soda if you're looking for a home remedy. I did post a recipe for that in my black spot on roses video. I'll link that one up above, which I have found to be relatively effective for reducing black spot, but not causing harm on my plants. But for the use of vinegar, they haven't come to any conclusions about what that level would be, so I would definitely not recommend it at this time. Use number five I've heard proposed is as an animal repellent. And again, this is one of those ones where you would put the vinegar straight into a sprayer and you would spray it around the margins of your property or around your patio or deck and try to keep animals away. Things like deer or rabbits or other troublesome animals. This is a terrible use for vinegar. This one doesn't make the grade. I'm gonna give this one an F straight away. First of all, it doesn't persist. So if you spread your vinegar around the yard today, 2 hours later, 3 hours later, it will have volatilized, it'll be gone, it won't be repelling anything, even assuming it ever did, which I'm a little questionable about. Second thing is that spraying vinegar straight onto anything like masonry, plastic, metal, it's corrosive. So you're gonna see damage, marking, etching on the things that you spray it onto. So it's just a really bad idea. Now on this one, I don't have a great alternative. I know that for deer, if that's your problem, there is a granular repellent on the market called the plant skid. But as for other ones, I've heard things for rabbits, like a blood meal. There's other ones that I heard that you would spread that imitate the urine of predators. You may have to research these, but the truth is, I don't have a really good solution. Animals getting into your garden and eating the plants is one of the classic problems of gardeners, and I don't think there is a magic bullet for them, to be truthful. Number six, and I couldn't believe my ears when I saw this one in the videos on YouTube about using it to kill slugs and snails. This is akin to throwing salt on slugs and snails as a slow way to pull out their moisture, or in this case, to dissolve them. I think there's probably less inhumane ways to kill your slugs and snails. I'm gonna give this one an F. Number seven, I've seen it recommended as a way to aid germination as a dilute vinegar solution soak in seeds before you plant your seeds. This one was intriguing to me because I hadn't heard it before, so I wanted to look into it and see what evidence there was. In the end, I'm giving it an F because the only one study I could find on it, they tried it on eggplant seedlings and they tried a bunch of different concentrations of vinegar, and basically every concentration of vinegar slowed down germination. So it wasn't positive, it was towards the negative, and so it goes to show that once you test some of these home remedies in real world situations or scientifically, sometimes they won't hold up. On to number eight is to use vinegar to dissolve calcium in things like eggshells or lime to try to add calcium to cure blossom and rot. That's a mouthful. Yes, the concern is that blossom and rot is a physiological disorder that happens in your tomatoes or peppers when the blossom end of the fruit starts to rot due to a temporary lack of calcium. The problem with this, and I'm going to give this one a C minus or a C, it can work. If you do dissolve your calcium or eggshells into the vinegar, it does make a water-soluble version of calcium that you can put into the soil. The problem with curing blossom end rot with it is that blossom end rot is, like I said, a physiological disorder. It's usually more related to an uneven uptake of moisture in your plants. So too much water or too little water or an uneven watering can often do it. Second thing to say is that calcium availability in the soil is a very, very complicated thing. All of you people who are throwing Epsom salts into your gardens indiscriminately should take warning about that, because magnesium can interfere with the uptake of calcium. So on this one, I would say yes, technically you can use the vinegar to dissolve a calcium source and add calcium. But as for alternatives to it, one, I would say water your peppers and tomatoes more regularly as a first step. And if you do find a calcium deficiency, you could try this, or you could use something like calcium chloride or calcium nitrate, each of which is inexpensive, readily available, and fully soluble, so you don't have to use vinegar to dissolve it. Number nine is the use of dipping your cuttings like these into vinegar before you stick them to try to root your plants. I don't know what the theory is behind this one. I guess you may as well include apple cider vinegar as a solution for rooting hormone, because people use everything for it. People talk about using honey, cinnamon, bananas, aloe vera, onions. Hey, why not vinegar? Except, you know, I give it some pause with vinegar, because vinegar, as we know from previous discussion, is a bit of a corrosive. I guess in a mild version, you could make the argument that it could work as a disinfectant. I don't know, but I couldn't find any studies to support its use, and so I'm going to give this one an F as just completely unsupported. And finally, number 10 is the recommendation to use vinegar as part of a recipe to build a trap for fungus gnats or fruit flies. And so it usually goes in with a sugar source, some vinegar, and then there's some sort of an inverted bottle thing that you use to try to trap your fungus gnats or your fruit flies. The problem with this approach, and I'm going to give it a C because I've seen it work, I've seen traps like these work against fruit flies and fungus gnats. The problem is it doesn't break their life cycle. So if you have houseplants, for instance, that have fungus gnats breeding, or in your propagation area have fungus gnats breeding in the soil of your plants, that's where they do their most damage, and this trap will do nothing to solve that. So I'm going to give it a C because I think it can work, but it really doesn't address your problem. Your problem is those larvae of the fungus gnats that are attacking the roots of your young plants, and in that case I've done a video on fighting fungus gnats. I will link that above, but the solution on it really is to go for either something like Steinernema, which is a predatory nematode that attacks the fungus gnat larvae, or to go for something like BTI, which will also, as a bacteria, will attack those larvae. All right, thanks so much for watching my video today. It's an interesting thing to see what people will do when they see a folk remedy and they try to apply it to garden situations. If you have any questions about that or any other folk remedies in the garden, please drop those below the video and we can talk about it.